have a few minutes here at the end of the ship where I'd like to tell you about our activities on board, tell you about the major components of the Space Radar Laboratory, talk about our science goals for the week's activities, and tell you about some of the examples of global change that we look forward to sharing with the people and the scientists back on Earth. This Space Radar Lab 2 is part of NASA's mission to planet Earth. That's a program that NASA's conducting to look at Earth's life, land, water, the air around the planet, and all the interactions of those components. We're trying to understand Earth as a single complex system so that we can get a handle on the real numbers behind the changes our globe is experiencing. Now, the Space Radar Lab goal as a part of Mission to Planet Earth is to look for those hard numbers on Earth's changes, both man-made and natural, and try to bring those back to Earth so we can understand how we're affecting the planet and how we have to cope with those changes. Now, to do that, we have a payload bay full of sophisticated instruments that last flew in April on STS-59, and I'd like to tell you a bit about those, and I've got a little video segment here to show you those components. The first component we have on board Space Radar Lab is a state-of-the-art imaging radar, and we're going to show you here in this view as we come down from the overhead windows our Circe XR radar out in the payload bay. The other component of SRL is the MAPS air pollution sensor, and in this view of the payload bay, you can see the large radar array stretching from about the forward end of the bay all the way back to the tail. It's labeled JPL, that's the Circe XR instrument. The Langley Research Center logo is on the MAPS instrument, just to the right of the screen, to the left of the Canadian arm. And the small segment of antenna labeled XR is the German-built component of Space Radar Lab. Now, these sensors in the cargo bay aren't very useful unless we have the crew here on board to operate them. For the imaging radar part of the mission, the crew has an essential role to play. There's a huge amount of data coming down from the instrument out there as it images the Earth's surface, and those images have to be transferred to the ground. We don't have enough communications link on board to transfer them all in real time. So the first role of the crew is to handle the data coming back from the radar, and we do that by changing out our data tapes on board. We have about 207 data tapes on board. Each of them holds 50 gigabytes of data, and we've gotten very good at practicing changing out those tapes. We hope to bring back about 52 terabits of data, something like 20,000 encyclopedia volumes of information by the time we're finished. The second part of the crew's role is to handle the photography that supports the science investigations around the world. In many regions of the world, we don't have scientific teams on the ground to validate the results from the radar or from the MAPS pollution sensor. And so we are the ground truth. Our photography, some 14,000 still photo frames, is going to be used to provide the environmental conditions over those targets in remote areas of the globe that don't have independent verification. And the last thing we're doing, and probably the most important role that the crew's playing on this mission, is to point the payload bay instruments at the required targets. And to do that, we're conducting a succession of maneuvers, about 409 of them during the mission. And that's about 25,000 computer keystrokes to tell Endeavour's computers how to orient the payload bay so as to get the optimum data coming back down to the ground. Now, the radar out in the cargo bay, Circe XR, is a synthetic aperture radar, and it paints a picture of the Earth's surface through darkness and clouds and can thus operate around the clock all the way around our orbits every 90 minutes around the globe. The MAPS pollution sensor is an infrared spectrometer, and it measures the amount of heat radiation coming up from the ground and converts that into information on how much carbon monoxide is lying just beneath the space shuttle as we go around the planet. And over a couple of days, we can construct a map of pollution sources and the way the CO is moving around the world on a day-to-day basis. And this is a very good comparison with information we got last spring and on two previous flights of MAPS. And this is just the key to our whole mission, just looking for changes around the world. We're looking for changes since last April's STS-59 mission, Space Radar Lab 1. We're looking for changes in the previous MAPS data over the last 10 years. And these two flights and other flights in NASA's Mission to Planet Earth will show the ability to monitor the Earth as a global system on a permanent basis. We're looking for changes like ecology changes, changes around the world, climate changes, and some dramatic changes on the surface that we're more familiar with, like volcanoes and storm systems, for example. In the area of ecology, we're looking at clearing and deforestation around the world, looking at the tropical and northern forests of the world to see the rate at which we're destroying the forests and the rate at which they're renewing themselves, so we can really quantify that important phenomenon in the ecosystem. We've already seen a lot of forest fires over in Asia and in Australia, some at night over Africa and in South America as well. And our data, when we come back, will give us the rates of forest change around the world. In terms of pollution, we're looking for the way that carbon monoxide drifts around the world from its sources like forest fires, and that will help us track seasonal pollution and also tell us what the most important sources are in various seasons, whether it's natural burning from forest fires or industrial sources like cities and automobiles. We're looking for climate change by looking at the geology around the world for traces in the geologic past of rainier and drier periods in the Earth's deserts and the valleys that show alluvial fan erosion. Those are very key points to investigate for looking back into the Earth's climatic past. And of course, some of the most dramatic things we're seeing in terms of change have been the volcanic eruptions up in Kamchatka yesterday and the day before. And we've also been looking at several storm systems down in the Southern Ocean that we can track on a day-to-day basis. And there are targets for both the radar and some of the MAPS instruments because those storm systems can distribute pollution around the world. We have a busy week ahead of us here on Space Radar Lab. We've got a lot of work to do in terms of maneuvering, changing the tapes, and most important for us on a daily basis is taking all those still photos from the aft windows. It keeps us constantly busy when there's a daylight pass going on. That's not surprising. The Earth is a very complex system. It takes a lot of study to understand it, and only a future permanent platform or a suite of instruments in orbit is going to be able to do that on a permanent basis. And we hope that by flying this testbed, we'll prove that that principle will in fact work. We're getting a taste of some of the exciting results that we're anticipating here in orbit with our own eyes, and it's going to be an exciting look at the data when we get back to the ground with those 207 data tapes and really see in full fidelity what the Circe XR and MAP sensors have brought back. But we can see the changes here, and we're going to try to show them with you in the coming week. Okay, Houston, you should be getting this view of the Kuchiskoya volcano. You can see the snow-capped upper slopes, and then there's a very active eruption going on from the northeast portion of the mountain. Desimiani is behind the smoke plume. Looks like from the shadow height, you can even estimate the height of the eruption plume, but we're guessing at least 35 or 40,000 feet. And that dark gray dust plume goes downwind at least 500 kilometers, if not more. Okay, now this is a going away shot, Houston, of the volcano. You can still see the lava flows at the top of the screen where the eruption is actually originating. And this gives you a good view of the profile of the plume. And there's another wide shot that Dan took starting just now that shows you the extent of the ash plume.
This is Mission Control, Houston. We are receiving some data from the Space Radar Laboratory instruments. This particular data is coming down real time, or near real time, and is data as of the Kamchatka Peninsula. The orbiter is flying over this peninsula that is to the east of Russia and on the western side of the Bering Sea.
Houston Endeavor, you should be getting that video now.
That's firm, Dan. It's, once again, really just a fantastic video image.
From the synthetic aperture radar instrument on board Endeavor as it passes over the Raco, Michigan supersite. These are live pictures from the XR instrument. Braco, Michigan is one of the ecology sites being studied.
The ground looks just like it did then. We have a beautiful mosaic of fall colors beginning to develop. And you should be beginning to see lots of reds and yellows as you look down over our site in the days to come. You know,
certainly be looking for it. The lighting so far has made it a little hard to distinguish colors, but we have noticed a little bit greener inland and near the coastal lines of the Great Lakes. It's looked a little bit more fall-like.
Well, that should be proceeding along rather quickly now. We've had two nights of good hard frosts with clear weather and the drying, so fall is coming quickly upon us.
And Endeavor's now moving across the northwestern portions of Africa. Again, using the synthetic aperture radar, it's very evident that the orbiter's now crossing over land. This is a geological site, a super site again, over the Sahara Desert area. The Sahara is an area which is about the size of the United States. Prior to its becoming a desert area, it had been apparently well laden with fairly major drainage networks. With increasing dominance of the wind and the sands and the channels and the various floodplains of the rivers began to be reworked into thin sheets and eventual scattered dunes.
This is Mission Control Houston. We're now receiving some additional real-time downlink from the synthetic aperture radar instrument in Endeavour's payload bay as it flies 118 nautical miles over the coast of Japan. With us again is Dr. Jeffrey Plout, the geology representative for CIRSE XR. Dr. Plout, what are we looking for in these XR images?
Well, at this point, we're traveling over the Sea of Japan, and this is the strait between the main continent of Asia and Japan. And we will be coming up shortly on the Sarobetsu test site, which is the northern tip of the island of Hokkaido, which was the vicinity of the offshore earthquake earlier today.
Dr. Platt, is there any possibility we'll see any change in the shoreline because of the waves that have been in the area?
That is the type of observation that we would be interested in making, and in this case perhaps looking for ponded water or any bright radar returns from the near shore area. Here we're coming over the southwest corner, and then beyond in the top of the screen there is the northeast section of the island, and there's no obvious evidence of damage, but this is going by rather fast, and we'd certainly need more time to sit down and do a detailed processing and analysis of the image.
And the next data take underway with the synthetic aperture radar in Endeavour's payload bay as the orbiter tracks northeast, now approaching the Great Lakes region. The Raco, Michigan supersite is located on the eastern end of Michigan's upper peninsula. The particular site of interest is located between forested regions and the northern temperate forest, which is known as a transitional zone that is expected to be ecologically sensitive to global changes. The baseline studies are of the vegetation areas, and those areas are essential for being studied in monitoring the global changes. Again, the orbiter is tracking along the Great Lakes area to the northeast.
Coming up, here's the shoreline of one of the islands. And we can clearly see the volcanoes on those islands. These are some of the most remote volcanoes in the world and some of the least studies because of the remoteness and the difficulty of getting to them. In addition, this area is often cloud covered and makes it difficult for aerial observations or satellite observations.
Once we get the radar set up and ready to go, it's ready to start taking data. And the next scene that you're going to see is a picture of us passing over the Sahara Desert. As you can see, that to the eye, it doesn't look very like there are many features. But when you turn the radar on, this is what the radar can see underneath the ground or ancient riverbeds. And that was part of our study. This was a geological site that we wanted to understand the history of how the Sahara Desert became what it is today, because obviously its climate in the past must have been very different to have these riverbeds underneath.
Now we were looking.
Is it cloud covered at all, Dan?
Say again?
Is it open? Wide open?
It's wide open.
Yeah.
Oh, wide open.
Great.
That stops for me. 5-6. 5-6. Oh, yeah, you should hear. It's told us directly right over here. I see it.
This is Mission Control. Houston Endeavor's tracking across the northeast portions of North America just to move off the coastline just to the north of Newfoundland. Views coming from the payload bay cameras aboard the orbiter.
I see where it is. You see the pincers, and there's kind of like a little gradual bend.
Yep.
It's after that gradual
after that
bend.
Gradual bend with a little harbor there.
Yep.
Okay. Is it cloud covered at all, Dan?
Say again?
Is it open? Wide open?
It's wide open.
Yeah.
It's
oh,
wide open.
Great.
That stops for me. 5-6. 5-6.
Oh, man, you should hear. It's almost directly right overhead.
I see it. I see it.